Once again, we're here at the place, and tonight we are excited to have some of the most wonderful people in the world, and that would be Fabio and Vincent Deporter. And my hosts tonight are Bob Graves and Daryl Furlow. Now, this is going to be the kind of show that may get a bit sensitive, in that it's difficult to talk about because so many people have been victimized. We're talking about lots and lots of terror, lots of people killed, and the killing keeps going on and on and on and on. And this is just so tragic. This is not just a local problem somewhere else. This is a problem all over the world. We're talking about terrorists who have committed themselves to killing everyone who doesn't believe or think or act like they do. And so here we are at the beginning of the show trying to nuance the importance of staying in the conversation, staying in the process of trying to figure out how do we change this paradigm? What do we need to say, first of all, to the victims? To the families, to those people who are hurting so, so much. I mean, I can't say enough. We care so much. We're broken hearted. It's not just the people in Paris, but we're talking about refugees who are trying to escape, you know, these countries where all of this stuff is going on. I see children walking in the mud. I see children trying to make it across the seas in a boat, drowning, becoming victims just because they had to flee such persecution and violence. And so tonight's show is not going to be with a lot of laughter, but it's going to be, how do we change? That is, this thing that we call a planet. We're atheists and theists alike, but here we can work together, we can think together, we can love together, we can change that dynamic. I'm convinced of that. And so I invite you to the conversation. With that said, Bob, welcome.
Well, thank you. I'm looking forward to tonight's show. Not as excited as I usually am, but the lack of excitement isn't because our show won't be a strong or useful one, but rather because we're really going to be kind of sobering tonight and talking about the current issues that have been going on that no matter what your attitude or philosophy is as to explain what's going on, there's just no denying that some of the recent events are shocking and very disappointing.
Daryl, What say you about this tragedy, about these events?
Well, you know, to me, this is where the rubber meets the road. You know, it really gives everyone an opportunity to know where each individual is at, you know, where our hearts are. You know, I think you're exactly right when you say this is not just something that pertains to Paris or certain locations or a certain group of people, but it's people, and that's what matters. And especially when you're dealing with innocent people, just Someone that is trying to terrorize people to the extent that you feel like, or to try to make people feel like they're not safe anywhere. And the one thing that I see that to me is very encouraging is people banding together, people coming to one another's rescue, and there just seems to be a lot of caring right now, and I hope that pattern continues.
Excellent. I'd like to bring in Fabio and Vincent at the same time. Welcome, guys. You guys just start talking. Fill us in. You guys, I mean, Fabio, you live in Italy, and Vincent, I think that you were born in Belgium. Is that correct?
Correct. Yes, I lived in Belgium and in France. I lived in France for 23 years, 10 of them in Paris.
Wow. And you have loved ones there? And
yes, I do. Yeah, I have family.
Were any of them hurt during this?
No. Fortunately, everybody's accounted for, and my mom and sister lives in the south of France, so they're closer to Fabio. But I have a lot of friends in Paris, and this comes off right after my friends from Charlie Hebdo also got murdered. So it's a tragedy,
Fabio, what say you about the entire ordeal here? I mean, what's going on?
Well, a couple of things. The first one is that I don't want people think, and well, that shouldn't be difficult. I am in no way, shape, or form any kind of expert in these kind of things. I'm not. My main focus is not geopolitics. It's not terrorism. It's not at all. I'm just a regular guy, which has been working in IT for more than 25 years. I've worked with governments, I've worked with big companies, and the only time that I've, I've had to deal, with a war was when I was going with reliefs in Bosnia in 93. I'd been shot a couple of times in Mostar, unloading crates in the hospital, but that's the only thing that I, the only things I've been directly involved.
You've been shot?
Yeah, a couple of times, yeah. They missed, but yeah, it was close enough to be scary.
I mean, talk to me about that for a moment.
Well, it happened a couple of times. It happened the first time in Mostar, when we were unloading crates at the hospital in Mostar during the Bosnia-Herzegovina war in 93 or 94, I can't remember. And the second time we were shot while we were going to Sarajevo and the second convoy. But yeah, I mean, well, it was close. No, nobody got hurt, but it's not funny when you
right
hear the bullets. So, but anyway, this is just to give you. I had to say that because I've seen a lot of amateur generals and experts in terrorism right now, and it's it's something which has always bothered and puzzled me. The situation is troublesome. It is worrying. We in my country right now we are going to have, I think, in 3 weeks or stuff like that in Rome, there's going to be a jubilee. So, I mean, the timing is perfect and tension is high. We've had some reports of potential attacks, of course, in St. Peter and in Milan at the Dome and at the Scala Theater. The problem is that those are really asymmetrical attacks. And there is no way you can prevent them, effectively, unless you use proper intel and proper forces. There is no defense against a car which drives by and shoots to a bar. There is no defense, people, getting in a theater, in a concert, a really small theater. You cannot cover these things up. So, this is, I think. This is the biggest problem, and I know Vincent is really close to that, but in a way, this is more troublesome than the attacks at Charlie Hebdo, because at least with that, there might have been, I don't want to say an excuse, but there might be a target.
Yes, now, I agree.
Yeah. Now there is no target. Everybody's a target. And it's a, and I find it, you know, really troublesome that it happened. Of all the towns in Europe, in Paris, because it has a great nightlife. Everybody goes out. The bars are always full, even, you know, if the weather right now is terrible. It's colder than we see it, but, you know, everybody's out. And if you take away from the people this freedom of going outside and living the life and being French, basically,
yeah,
that's the biggest problem right now.
Wow.
I agree with you, Fabio. Of course, the Charlie Hebdo touched me personally, but this being said, like you say, you know, my friends, I will tell you, they knew this could happen. They were very courageous, but they knew that they were targets, and they knew they might not live an old life. They knew it. So it's like you say, it was targeted at somebody who actually knew what was going to happen. Now, what you say is true. Now it's all about innocent people. People who are having a good time with family or at a bar or, you know, simply walking in the street. These people are not people who have provoked anything. My friends did provoke. They did it. They're provocateurs, you know. They did it on purpose. And their message went through very well. They died for it, but it went through. But here we're talking about people who are just being happy or being together. And that is tragedy, really.
You know, one of the things that I've viewed here more recently was actually a conversation between a young boy and his father. And the son, the little boy, he was afraid. And he was wondering, how are we going to protect ourselves? And this was filmed in France. And his father said something along the lines with a flower. And here we have people so, so kind, so filled full of love and compassion, standing up, saying things like, we're not afraid of you, speaking to the terrorist, and not picking up a gun, but picking up flowers and saying, we're going to be fine. So the question would be, what's going on in that kind of philosophy? Because I'd like to explore that a bit, because I think that so many times we think that violence can end violence. I'm not convinced of that. And so what say you, either one of you?
I think that violence does not stop violence. I think it just it's like an escalator. It just goes up, and that's about it, you know. So I don't think it helps. However, I don't know if I'm like Fabio. I'm not a specialist in warfare. I do know it's necessary sometimes, but I also believe that peace is the best way to go, if possible.
Let's speak from the standpoint of being a humanist and just take it from there. You know, none of us are specialists. That is, we don't have available data, facts concerning X, Y, and Z pertaining to ISIL. But we do know something about humanism, about the human condition in a sense, something that we would like to see. And so let's see what we can put on the table when it comes to that. Fabio, what are your thoughts?
Well, I would say that the one we saw in France, and by the way, I saw the video that you were talking about. It was really touchy.
Yeah, I cried like a baby. I mean,
of course. I mean, I did too. Well, I'm kidding. But the kind of reaction that you saw is not an uncommon reaction. I'm not really sure about France, but during the 70s and the 80s, especially in the 80s, what in Italy were called the lead years, lead because, you know, the bullets are made of lead. And basically we had the big insurgency of, you know, the Red Brigades in Italy, they had the Biedermeinhof and the Rote Armee Fraktion in Germany, all, you know, during the terrorist years. This kind of reaction is the I would say, common reaction. It is an understandable reaction, and it is, in my opinion, it is the right reaction for the reasons that I said before. These terrorist acts, they want to disrupt the connectivity of the society. They are going to hit the society where it hurts. They are going to eat in stadiums. They're going to eat where people gather around, where they're not thinking. You know, they're thinking about having a good time or going outside and doing that kind of, or driving the car on an highway or riding the train, you know, to holidays. And they put a bomb on the train, you know, they put a bomb in the square. They pass with the car and they level, you know, the bars with machine guns. So I see that reaction as really possible. It's the only possible reaction. It is the society which says, you know what, we're still here. We are going to remember that, but we're going to leave nonetheless. There are two things to consider with this phenomena, and it's not the same as the terrorist one that I said before. We have terrorist acts which are being pursued in nations like France. They had the attack of the museum in Libya, in Tripoli, if I'm not wrong. Those are terrorist acts. And then there is a war. There is a war in the ISIS occupied territory. Those are two things that must be dealt in a different way. So even I understand the popular reaction of François Hollande, which, you know, sent immediately airplanes to bomb ISIS, 20 bombs, you know, to bomb ISIS. I can understand that from a demagogic point of view, but they must not be put in relation. This is not the way that you will avoid people blowing up themselves in Berlin or in Rome or in London.
Right. Yeah. Let me ask, go ahead.
Who?
Okay, I thought that I heard someone's voice.
I was just agreeing with Fabio. The problem is this. This is the way I see it. I agree that there's a war on one side and then there's the terrorism on another. And I feel they're just thugs. I mean, don't these people realize that we get stronger together? That after 9/11, for example, people got together, America got together. The world was American at that point. Today the world is French because, of course, we get together. I don't imagine one second that they don't know that they're not going to convert us to Islam. What I do believe, though, is that they are thugs. They are bad people that should be taken care of by Al-Qaeda even, or by Muslims themselves. I have a hard time believing that these people are religiously, they use religion, no doubt, like Hitler used religion, but that they are using it to execute people in the name of Allah, I'm not so sure. I don't know, I just say I'm not sure.
Well, you know, there's a principle here, I think, that possibly gets overlooked. You know, obviously the makeup of ISIS is of individuals, and of course I rack my brain sometimes trying to figure out what kind of appeal would make an individual say, I want to join that, I want to kill people, I want to possibly put on a suicide vest and kill as many as I can before I take my own life. And the only motivation that even comes to mind would be complete misery. And, you know, if you go into a place such as Paris where people are having a good time and you're somehow motivated to try to destroy that, the only motivation I can think of is a miserable person, one that is not able to enjoy that sort of thing. And mm-hmm. like they weren't invited to the party, so they're going to blow up the party. And, you know, that, like I said, that's the only motivation I can think of other than, you know, I've wondered, what are these people promised? You know, if you'll go in and do this thing, you're not going to get paid because you're not going to be alive at the end of it. So it has to be something after this life. And I know that that
is that much of a mystery. To be honest with you, I don't think it's that much of a mystery. I think the answer to that question is one we don't like hearing, and so when we hear it, we reject it. When we take a look at most terrorists are well-educated, oftentimes college-educated people. They have often been schooled in Western colleges. Usually what I think also is, and this isn't true of all of them, but it's true of many of them, they are people who identify with and represent in their actions and activities other people whom they perceive to be deeply disadvantaged. And so, this is what motivates them. They're trying to make a statement on behalf of other people. I think people like Osama bin Laden, for example. I think that Osama bin Laden was of the opinion that the United States government was involved in great evil against a great number of the civilians of the Arabian countries. And not that he's saying that they were directly doing it, but in many ways, the United States government, as he saw it, was making sure that the people who were in control in the Middle East were the best puppets they could set up, or people who they had made deals with so that they were in bed together, as it were. And he perceived the United States government as being responsible for the major suffering of the common person. And so he sees himself as a hero to these people, willing to die on their behalf to end their suffering against an empire, a regime that he perceives to be quite evil. Now, when people hear that, they think, well, we're not evil. I don't know that we're pristinely wonderful. I don't think we're as evil as they may perceive us to be, but I think that most Americans are unaware of the kind of suffering that goes on in the Middle East with the average citizen because of the kind of suffering that is sustained through U.S. foreign policy and other Western policies and the policies that are maintained by these five permanent members of the Security Council of the UN. And so as a result, I believe these people are deeply dedicated to a mission, and many of these terrorists have a wonderful nightlife. You know, they go out to the parties and they have a great time. It's that their dedication to a cause is willing to die for it, and it's a cause that I think we write them off by thinking, well, they must be insane, they must be animals, they must be, and we basically we don't want to believe that we might have played a role in it, or we might be perceived as playing a role in it that we're not playing, but that we're perceived to play in it. And I really think that that is the major motivation behind terrorism. Now, that's the motivation behind it. Why do they move to terrorism? Well, they tried to attack our economic system by knocking down the Twin Towers and making a statement against our military by hitting the Pentagon. But generally speaking, the reason why they resort to terrorism is because they can, and they think they're wrong, but they think that our reaction to this terrorism is going to be, oh, well, let's go insist that our governments change their policies. And we don't do that. We huddle together. We say, well, they've attacked us. Let's go get them. You know, and in fact, we do the same thing they do because we're both human beings. They think they're going to lash out at us and show us, and we think we're going to lash back and show them, and it never works. Either side. I think it's an insanity of escalation, and terrorism strikes me as being the next logical step for war, seeing as that nuclear war isn't really an option, and the United States of America has such powerful conventional weaponry. You're not going to win a conventional war against the United States. You're just not going to do it, you know. And so there's a sense in which this remains one of the only options left. I still see it as insane. I still see it as evil. But I don't think that we gain anything by looking at the people who are engaged in this by saying, you know, what kind of crazy animals are they, or what, you know? No, I think the motives they have make complete sense to them based on the perspective they perceive, and a perspective that is filled with a variety of both truths and misperceptions. And so, you know, I really see that as what's going on myself personally.
I see what you say, Bob, and I agree with you, except that I do think that, on the other hand, they are recruiting kids, by the way, or young men who are actually just there to look at a riot in the street, how it turns fast to people breaking windows and then stealing and, you know, looting. I do think that you're right on the basis. But I also believe that there are a lot of thugs, a lot of kids that just want to create mayhem.
They have to turn the kids into thugs to do it. But again, the common thug who's involved and the people who are organizing these things may be operating on a different level.
Yes.
Right, yeah. And you know, it does take a great deal of thuggery. But, you know, it's not hard to turn people into thugs. In fact, I think we saw this in Baltimore. In Baltimore, they had this horrible riot not too long ago. A lot of people don't understand how it happened. And a lot of people think it was racism, but it was really a power struggle. And two things that happened that were really, I think, instrumental in creating that riot was, number one, they shut all the buses down before the riot began because they were anticipating it. But what that did, everybody who went to work that morning was unable to get back home. And yet they got out of work, and they're just out in the streets. Nowhere to go, those people who relied on the bus lines. All the kids who were in school got out of school, and they were let out of school, but there were no buses, and they also were not getting home right away. And then the police, wanting to make sure that things didn't get out of control, corralled everybody into it. So basically everyone was pushed together. They don't know why. They can't get to where they want to go. Tempers flare. And next thing you know, there's a riot. Really? You know, to me, that was like people not understanding human nature and turned them into a bunch of thugs. And it's amazing the kinds of things people will do in mass when they're a crowd. It is. It's sad. But I don't think the people of Baltimore are particularly rowdy, more so than other people. You push a lot of other people together like that. You're bound to let – and once tempers flare – people kind of let go in the anonymity and supposed safety of the group of numbers, you know?
I talked with a couple of psychologists and sociologists about this paradigm, and I asked, you know, this question, and I'm not suggesting that what they said was actually the problem, but it might be, but it's worth thinking about. But I asked, why are so many people here, especially young people, attracted to that kind of mentality that's going on within the context of ISIL? And this is what they said to me. They said, typically, what's going on here, they are appealing to people who are socially awkward, people who don't have jobs, people who don't, you know, necessarily have girlfriends or boyfriends, people who have little or no investment, that is, in the community. And so these people are trying to find, in a strange sense, some sense of identity. And so they were suggesting that this is what's coming from the United States to go over there to fight for ISIL, would be people who are maladaptive, that is, sociologically speaking.
Yeah, I agree. I think that makes a lot of sense. And in other words, I think that it's important that not all of our theories are going to be correct, but they may be interesting to consider. But we have to come up with answers that make human motivational sense, rather than trying to say, I can't imagine. Well, you know, you've never been in the kind of stress that some of these people live in. Many of the mass shooters, you know, the outcasts, people who were bullied as kids. I'm not saying this makes it an excuse, but, you know, we tend to live in a culture that that isolates and humiliates certain people as individuals or even as a group. And then somebody comes along that thinks in that isolationist attitude and in the immaturity of it that they're going to be the hero of these humiliated people. And when they do that, the things that they do are horrible.
Well, think about their name. And so many people have been asking the question, should we shut down some of the mosques here in America? And I guess maybe a question or two has been stated concerning should we shut down churches. Let me put this on the table, and it's just a thought. If a group of bad guys decided to be bad guys to all of mankind, could they not repurpose words in this sense? Could they not choose and say, hey, listen, we're going to call ourselves part of the Islamic faith, and we're going to claim that we have our own sense of place to go to, that is a mosque. And so maybe we're dealing with people who have a mosque that's not a mosque. They may have a caliphate that's not a caliphate. They may have, you know, ascribed themselves to a popular religion like the Islam faith, but they're truly not Islamic in any sense of the word. In fact, I had an imam here on the show two times here in the studio, and he's a wonderful person. He kept saying that people have hijacked, namely, their faith. Because, you know, he was sharing with me, he said, most Muslims don't even believe, that is, in their holy book, in that they look at it as just a narrative of analogy, a metaphor. They use it in a very loose sense. And he said, that's where most Muslims are today. He said, you have a few literalists, not many, and then you have the radicals. And he said, the radicals are extreme. And he's one among many professors who are trying to push back on these radicals. And so the question would be, if you did shut down a mosque, and if it was simply a mosque because it's been repurposed, would there be anything wrong with that?
Can I jump in?
Sure.
Two quick things, because this is where I usually this is where I get, you know, some opinions which they give me a lot of flack, you know, usually, especially right now. About the people involved in ISIS, we got to be really careful. We got to distinguish two kind of persons. The persons which are actually right now in Syria, that they are fighting for ISIS, and they're fighting for ISIS for reasons that are mostly, you know, the fact that, you know, it's right now it's a godforsaken country, bombs are falling over them, and, you know, if they find some crazy guy to say, oh, we got a good cause, you follow us, and they give them money. And I'll say money a lot of times right now, because I think this is where we have to follow. These are some people. The ones that have got the media attacks in Paris and Charlie Hebdo, let's not forget they were French and, you know, they were Europeans.
Yes.
They didn't come, you know, from, you know, with the immigrants and stuff like that. They were Europeans, okay? And we know there are a lot of foreign fighters in Syria right now.
Oh, yeah.
Those people, the people which, these are the kind of people that usually, but not always, but they're usually people which lives, they are outcasts, they are sociopaths, that they live in, you know, in the banlieue or, you know, in the extreme poor suburbs where they are, on paper, part of the society. They see the society and they cannot be part of it. It's like when there was the wall in Berlin. If you were in East Berlin, you could see the lights in West Berlin and you would never get them. So you were angry, you know, you were against your own government. The money, and then I'll stop with that point. Right now, a terrorist in either in Libya or, you know, in an ISIS controlled territory, he takes $100 a day. they get drugs for free. They get Viagra for free for raping, which is, you know, part of the deal. If you're a foreign fighter and you've been fighting for ISIS for more than 6 months, you get $200 a day. Now, $100 or $200 a day in those places is big money. It's a lot of money. If you live in a Parisian banlieue, you know, and you don't work or you got problems, you go over there, they give you a target, an objective, a faith, a cause to fight for, and plus they give you money and woman to rape, and you know, you go there. You're a sociopath. You go there and you do that. The religious problem, and this is the second point. I don't want to underestimate the religious problem. It is part of the equation. But right now, I think that it's a scapegoat. And it is being used by terrorists right now as a scapegoat. The very same way that they're trying to use the immigrants' problem as a scapegoat. It mm-hmm. seems to me that the Syrian passport that they found, you know, outside the Stade de Paris was fake. Yeah. There is a big discussion right now in Europe about the immigrants, and if one of them happened to be an immigrant, that would just give fuel, you know, to all the xenophobes that they don't want these people in there. And they use that. It's a from that point of view, it's a PR war. The religious problem, I don't buy that it is the main problem. And let me just make an example, and then I shut up. I know I go on for too much. But, so please, you guys, you know, just wave flags and do some stuff.
No, you keep talking, which is wonderful.
But, you know, I just make an example why I don't think the religious problem is such a big problem for ISIS. The Kurds. Why are they killing the Kurds? The Kurds are a population which they are historically allied with Western countries. 80% of the Kurds are Sunni, the same, you know, as ISIS. There is a good number, the Shiite, someone Yazidi, but the reason why they're killing the Kurds is because it's a social and cultural war. The retaliation in Paris, and this is where I think it differs from the attacks in Al-Qaeda. Al-Qaeda made an unprovoked attack to US. 7 days before the attacks, France bombed Syria. Bombed ISIS encampment. This, by the way, was criticized by a lot of countries, including Italy. And the prime minister said, you know, that, yeah, it's all good and well, but we must not have uncoordinated attacks. We cannot have another Libya. The bombing in Libya, which, by the way, was made by France, you know, against the Gaddafi regime, this is where, you know, it brought us. We have a country in shambles. There are three countries over there, you know. If you go over there, you know, if you guys want to go to Libya, please tell me where you're going to get a passport for that, where you got to get a visa. There is no bloody government over there.
Yeah.
So, okay, I quit. I mean, I just want to say those things, you know, because I think they're quite
You mentioned
important.
Money there a couple of times, and that is a huge thing for a lot of the people. Do you guys know where they get the money from? How does ICE
from oil. Oil.
They take over oil fields in Syria and in Iraq. And
they estimate that they're getting $2 million a week just from oil.
It's a day.
No, it's $2 million a week.
Yeah.
Just from oil. Just right. From oil. It doesn't include kidnapping. It doesn't include, you know, gun smuggling. It doesn't include human trafficking. Those are for free. It doesn't include, you know, selling stuff that they raided from museums. It doesn't include all that stuff. Just from oil is $2 million a week. The attack on 9/11 cost $1 million. So the amount of money they took to plan and execute the attack on 9/11 was, you know, what, a 3 days' work for them.
You know, it's amazing. They've taken over these oil fields. Originally, in 2006, ISIS was an underfinanced, just insurgent group in Iraq. But they quickly learned how to become popular and where to get their money. And, of course, sometimes it takes money to make money, and it takes money to get in a position to make more money. And originally, many of the members of ISIS were, free Syrian army rebels that were armed and paid and trained by the United States, Saudi Arabia, Turkey. And then they were paid and trained and given arms. And then they went over to ISIS, who was then going to pay them and bring the arms with them and the training. And then other things that ISIS has done is this is amazing to me. When the United States decided it was time to leave Iraq, what did they do? They left. But when they left, they left their Jeeps, their Humvees, their weapons, their military staff. They left it all over there. You know, and so when ISIS was growing, they just went back and they grabbed all that equipment, you know, and it's like, so, you know, but the thing is this, somebody's selling them the guns, somebody's buying the oil, somebody's throughout the world is involved in part of the deals that are bringing the cash in, and we're going out there to bomb the oil fields. Why don't we go after we'd have to go after Turkey, wouldn't we? Because they're buying most of the oil. That's.
Oh, no. Everybody's buying the oil. Everybody's buying the oil. Okay, this is a question, Bob. You know, right now I think you're paying your gas. I think it's, what, $3.60 a gallon? How much is it?
It's come down here.
We're paying $1.94 a gallon here.
There you go. Now, imagine that tomorrow Obama says, you know what, you know, we got to stop ISIS, and unfortunately the first thing is going to happen tomorrow morning, you're going to pay gas $5 a gallon. You see? Everybody's silent because, you know, it drives me to the wall. It is bonkers, you know. It is the bloody money. It is a social and cultural problem over there. They've tried to establish a country, and now they're obviously defending the country. But it is, you know. They're attacking the countries which are bombing them.
Yeah.
What should we do? I mean, so many people here in the United States, especially these people who are running for president here in the States, they are suggesting X, Y, and Z. And for the most part, I'm ashamed of all of them. I have not found anyone, in my opinion, who's competent even to the question of what to do with ISIL. With that said, what are your ideas, Fabio, as to what to do with ISIL, how to approach them, how to put an end to them?
I don't know, but I want Vincent to talk. I'll be really brief. I said it before, even on Sunday, there are two things to keep, and I said it this evening too, there are two things to keep in consideration. We got to figure out what to do in Syria right now. That's one problem. And we got to figure out what to do with the terrorists, which are in our own country, and are eventually going to prepare things. For the second one, it's a police and intel job. You don't beat terrorism with soldiers.
No.
This has got to be extremely clear. If we don't want bombs to explode in our cities, that's a police matter. That's an intel matter. It's not, you don't send the army to deal with the terrorists. You send the army to deal with an army. And this is where I think it's got to do with Syria, or, you know, in the ISIS-controlled territory. But that's another big, you know, shitstorm, because they are in a country. They got Ahmadinejad. What do you do with him? You know, some people, you know, for the U.S. is the main problem. For Russia, it's not the main problem. And you cannot do those things together. Right now, the thing which might happen, and this is going to be a big problem, is if France decides to say, you know, fuck it, we're going to go and get them where they are in Syria, don't think that it's going to be a French or European problem, because you will have to go there too. Because France and Italy, they went to Afghanistan when you went to Afghanistan. They went to Iraq when you went to Iraq. And if the French or the Italian or the Germans, they go to Syria, you have to go to Syria too.
Yes.
Vincent, what are your thoughts on how do we stop this?
Well, I to be honest with you, I'm listening because Fabio pretty much pinned it down, I think. I think that it's true that there's the army should be taking care of the warfare, and then the police should be taking care of the terrorists. What my problem is with that is that I don't know if the police is trained enough for this, and I don't see them. When you get stopped for speeding 45 miles an hour, and you're just doing 45 miles an hour, but you're doing 10 miles more. You sometimes look at the police and you say, what the fuck are they doing? When you see our prisons in America that are filled with people who are caught with marijuana, which is nothing. It's nothing. It's not a crime. It's nothing to be caught with marijuana. And the prisons are filled with guys and girls that are caught like that. They should be ashamed of themselves. Instead of doing that kind of shit, they should be indeed collecting intelligence and taking care of terrorism, because that is the big problem. But no, we have these petty, shitty little lawsuits, and the prisons are filled for nothing in this country. So I get mad. To be honest with you, I'll stop there because I'm getting really mad.
Between drug arrests for moderate drug use such as marijuana, and asset forfeiture laws that the police are using, it is amazing that we don't have more people angry about some of the things that are going on in our own police force. And we have a disappearing middle class, which means we have a growing number of people who are struggling and a little bit worried about how they're going to make ends meet, how they're going to prepare for retirement. And we tend to live in an economy where even if you have a good job, if you lose that good job and it takes you too long to get another job, the longer you've been without a job, the harder it's going to be to get one, because people wonder, why have you been without a job so long? And we're getting to it.
It's terrible. Yeah.
It's becoming a cycle there. And, you know, years ago, a lot of people have forgotten this, but years ago, the Muslim movement in America was very evangelical and getting a lot of converts and growing. How? By going to the prisons and visiting the people who were there under the drug charges, people who were there who felt that they were penalties they were receiving were perhaps in some ways much too severe, or people who felt that they were targeted in particular because of their particular race or economic status. And as a result, these people who were in many ways, for various different reasons, disadvantaged, found, wow, someone's reaching out to me. And I think that when it comes down to political and religious recruitment, trying to find the people who feel like their future doesn't look so good, those are the people who are really primed and ready. And I am concerned that in the United States of America, with the disappearing middle class, that we might inadvertently be growing up a whole group of people who are going to be ready to riot.
Okay, let me put something
that's
on
true.
The...
Yeah.
Okay, excuse me. Go ahead, Vincent.
When I was a Jehovah's Witness, I knew a lot of elders that went to the prisons, and it's exactly what you say, Bob. It's they're taking advantage of a situation of being in prison for things that are really maddening. It's not that I'm defending drugs. It's not that. But let's be honest here. People, and I know a few, people who take drugs even harder than marijuana are often doing that because their life sucks, because they've been abused as kids or whatever the reason is. Putting them in jail just makes it worse. So once you, you know, it's just the very people who need support, who need compassion because they had such a bad life are the people who are indeed grasping for drugs, get caught and go to prison. And what does that do? What does that help? You know, we're doing the wrong thing. Instead, you know, it just makes me mad. And like I said, I'm not a proponent of, I don't, you know, want to glorify drugs, you know.
Vincent, that's not the point. We're back to the issue of money when it comes to prisons. Mm-hmm. It's a money-making business more than anything else.
Oh, yeah. So is war.
It is.
And when there's money to be made, I'll tell you what, nobody is going to go to Congress and lobby and say, look, we make military products and, you know, business has been slow lately, so we need you to kind of, you know, get busy and making trouble around the globe. No lobbyist is going to go down to Congress and lobby quite that way. But I'll tell you what, if you want war, what do you got to do? You have to invent an enemy. You have to talk about how bad that enemy is. You have to use words that incite. You have to control the media in a particular way so we can tell this story. And the best military strategy in the world to get people ready to fight is to make them feel like they're in great, great, great danger. And I'm not saying that the terrorism that's going on is not great danger. But you know what? If you want to put things in perspective, and I don't want to minimize what terrorism is, but in the United States of America, we've had fewer than 5,000 people die from an act of terrorism, I think, in our entire history within the United States of America. But we have twice that number die every year from drunk drivers. And nobody's afraid that someday they're going to get hit by a drunk driver. And, oh, my gosh, how are we going to do this? What are we going to do? When the truth is, the odds of you being killed by a drunk driver are so much greater than the odds of you're ever suffering personally from the act of a terrorist. But, you know, and I'm not saying that it isn't a bad thing. I'm just saying that, you know, look at the perspective here, you know. One of them is more connected with a money-making operation and something that is easy to get people's passions riled up about. And so what are we doing? We're having our buttons pushed as a society. Mm-hmm. I'm not saying we shouldn't respond to this. I'm not saying we shouldn't respond to it intelligently and, if we can, decisively. But I'm saying that, you know, someone's pushing our buttons.
Let me see if I can put something on the table, and you guys may agree or disagree. But if I were president of these United States, this is what I would do. And I'm just speaking just off the cuff. So I wrote a few things down, and so I will read a bit. First of all, I would take our military and I would cut it in half. In other words, I do think that we need a military force, but I think that half of our military force needs to become a mental health force. Let me state that again. We need half of our military to become a mental health force. That would mean that they need a lot of education, yada, yada, yada. With that said, if we had half of our military that was a mental health force, that means that we would have a chance to do cognitive therapy on a much larger scale when it comes to psychological and sociological paradigms. We might be able to fix or even get, you know, certain things to be managed. So it would be no longer just group therapy, but we do need what I would call or construe as global therapy. And so, you know, how do nations actually get along? How do in and out groups get along? I mean, we need to solve these problems, sociologically speaking, psychologically speaking, economically speaking. And so this brings a lot into the mix. When it comes to our military, I would say we don't need foot soldiers on the ground trying to do X, Y, and Z. What we need is special ops, people who are well-trained to deal with these particular people. Namely, if you are in the context of terrorists and you're not fighting, you know, oh, look at that guy, he's in a uniform, blah, blah, blah. We need special ops in that context. And then we need a president who is wise enough to say, you know, if you cut off the money, these guys can't do anything. And so you're taking care of a lot of things quickly instead of waiting around saying, wow, they have all this money. They're building, you know, quite the army. Because if we don't cut off the money flow of what these people are doing and how they're doing it, it's like, you know, Fabio was stating a while ago, if you're getting $2 million or plus a week, that's a lot of money to put in to...
I think latest figure shows higher than that.
Causing chaos. Yeah, it may be much, much larger than that. But my point is, we need a mental health force that's quite large. We need to educate people. We need to create jobs. We need to create social paradigms. These are the things that we can be focused on. It's not going to be solved by someone saying, okay, we're going to rise up with a gun and end this thing. I think that we're going to have to consider what truly will stop this kind of, and I call it insanity. And I think it's going to take much more than just a military force or a police force. I think it's going to take people who really know the mental and social paradigms. And so I'm in favor of that kind of force moving in, educating, creating models to where people can actually say, hey, you know, I was involved in this radical group and I heard someone say, hey, do you need some help? Because a lot of people who have been involved in these groups are walking away saying, this was nuts, and I'd like to give some people a bit of a chance to walk out of this before they do harm to other people. What say you?
I've heard there's a rumor that there's a Silverman Graves 2016 ticket.
That's good. That's good.
Somebody said that last show. They said, oh, yeah, Silverman and Graves, 2016.
The Italian prime minister this evening, he said something I'm quite proud of. And of course, you know, everybody now is laughing. And God forbid if something happened, it will be shredded. It will be skinned alive. But this evening on you know, on TV, he said that he's going to allocate more money against terrorism, but part of that money, and it will fall under the same umbrella of fighting terrorism, will be devolved to re-qualify the troubled neighbors, you know, what the French call the banlieue. I literally dropped, you know, I was eating and I dropped my fork and knife and said, what the fuck? We got a politician which seems to be to have alpha brain, you know, working between the ears. It's, I mean, it is something, you know, that goes along the lines of what Dr. Jones said before, you know. We got to understand, you know, that if we want to fight that problem, we got to identify the problem. We got to find the problem where the problem is, not what the problem might be.
Right, I agree.
One of the problems in throwing money at something, and not to say that things can be solved without spending money, but one of the problems when you spend money on a problem is that once you develop a method for spending the money on that problem, you kind of guarantee you can't solve the problem, because then the people who are making the money run out of job and run out of money. And so,
well, yeah, but I mean, but at least you're going to die trying.
Yeah. Sometimes those kinds of systems end up, let's just maintain it and make small improvements here and there. But that can sometimes be the big problem. That's why, you know, did you know that it originally in the United States of America, corporations that were first formed in America were formed for a particular task. Once the task was completed, the corporation was dissolved. Like you might have a corporation that was developed to build a bridge to go across from Manhattan to the other side of the river, of the Hudson or whatever. And once the bridge was built, the corporation ceased to exist. And but we don't do things like that anymore, do we? No. I guarantee they built a good bridge because there was no money to be made after the bridge was done because corporation would be dissolved and whoever owned the bridge would then have to be taking care of it and what have you. So, and they didn't want to be given a white elephant.
You know, I don't want to beat the dead horse. Are there some important things to say about Paris tonight? In other words, about the attack. Are there some things that we need to say about how to push back on ISIL?
There was a broadcast, I caught the tail end of it, on CBS, of all things. I don't suppose anyone has access to the nightly news on CBS where we could see a little their ending. Can anyone access that? What is his name? Scott... The news anchor for CBS.
Don't know.
He did a story on someone. I believe his wife, this young man, his wife was killed, possibly in the Paris attack, and they had a young child, and this man wrote a letter to the terrorist, and he started it out by saying something like, you will not get my hatred, and you will not destroy this bond between my son and I. He will grow up, and he will not fit into what you're trying to create. I mean, it was absolutely wonderful. I wish I could quote a little more of it. But,
I read the letter, yeah.
Did you? You saw that?
I did.
That, to me, that was extremely powerful, and he even stated that. He said, my son and I are just two, but we're stronger than all of you. And it was such a powerful statement toward just a resistance to the whole purpose behind terrorism. And I don't know how you can implement that on a large scale. But, you know, there again, that's one of those more or less intangibles. But it's something that's happening more and more, and I think that might do more to infiltrate the ranks of terrorism than anything else. It's just people showing instead of the retaliation, showing we won't go there, you know. And so, for what it's worth, you know. That brings up another point. It's a can of worms possibly we haven't opened, but this whole Syrian refuge issue, I think half of the states in this country have now said we will not accept refugees into our state. And I heard one response to that along this order, stating that this helps fulfill the purpose behind these attacks, possibly, by proving that this country has a hatred for people from that part of the world. Now, whether there's anything to that or not, I don't know. But if they can use it for propaganda to say, see, they hate you, they don't want you in their country, you know, maybe that is one of their goals.
Dr. Jones, you and I were one evening going to talk about the actionable purposes that lie behind speech, and in other words, that speech is often designed to create a response in other people in such a manner that the person who's speaking doesn't really have to take responsibility for the actions that they create within the other person that they speak to, a dynamic of speech. There's a sense in which I think we have to realize that a lot of behavior that goes on in the world, a lot of behavior that goes on in the news, is designed really to get us to respond in certain ways.
I agree. I mean, speech act theory is something that needs to be actually articulated more and more and more. That is, people need a good education as to what it is.
Not just speech act theory, but behavior act theory.
Exactly. But, you know, when people are educated and they can look at different paradigms for what they are, I think things will move forward. Daryl brought up something about, you know, what are we going to do with these refugees? You know, how is this going to look? I put something on our wall today, and it was a picture of some Indians, and he had this quote-unquote pilgrim. He's trying to get in, and the one Indian is saying to him, "Oh, no, we're not accepting any refugees." I thought it was funny. but my point is, here we are fleeing persecution, namely from those over in another country, and we come over here, and we give the Indians hell, and we con them, we do everything in the world, and this is the very thing that we did to the Indians is the very thing that we're afraid of. And so it is a bit of hypocrisy. It is a weird look. Do we have anybody here who would like to commit something to that conversation?
Well, you know, earlier you asked if there's anything that we could say about, you know, what do we do? One thing that my heart goes out to many of the people in Paris. There are people there who are deeply and troublingly touched. There's people who were planning on going out that night and didn't, and they're feeling like, oh my goodness, you know, I dodged a bullet here. There are people who lost loved ones,
yes,
family members, good friends, and to something that was just totally senseless, that accomplished really nothing, if except for perhaps more trouble. These people, grief and loss is phenomenal, and I think that they deserve our empathy and our concern, and our consolation, our sympathies. I cannot imagine just what it's like for many of those people to have this have happened to them. It's just unbelievable. I just can't imagine it. But at the same time, I wish I knew what the answer is. I don't have a good one. I don't like the answers we've been given. And I think that some of the best things that we can do are going to take a long time. And to work, I think we need to build better relationships around the world. That's going to take time. And there's a lot of healing that's going to have to go on in the meantime. And that's going to take a long time. And there's going to be potential snafus in pursuing that. And that's going to take some time. I think that in some ways, unfortunately, this is going to continue. Paris is just the beginning, perhaps, of a number of horrible acts. And in a sense, I mean, I don't want to sound so doomsday, but in a sense, this is the result of the fact that 10, 20 years ago, we weren't acting then in a way that was wiser. We acted as if we were never going to have to pay for a number of things, or didn't have to pay attention to a number of things. The things were going on really great, and in some ways, the dynamics we're facing now, as far as I can tell, are dynamics that have been rolling with inertia for a long time. And the things that are really going to respond and change this are things that are going to require a whole new inertia. It's going to take a whole lot of time to get it rolling. And in the meantime, a lot of the things that we might do to try to respond to this could destroy that new inertia. So this is a complicated issue.
It really is. But, you know, my greatest fear at this particular time in history would be our politicians, simply because we have so many of them that have this war dog mentality. For instance, Jeb Bush, he's, in my opinion, he's an idiot, and that's being kind. So many people think that George Bush created a system of peace and security for us who are Americans. And I'm scratching my head and saying, do what? You know, you had this doctrine of shock and awe. You're going to go and bomb all of these people, and you're going to have hundreds of thousands of civilians die. And you don't think that the aunts and the uncles and the cousins and the nephews, are you naive? Do you think that they're not going to somehow regroup and strike back at some point in history? I mean, we create enemies in doing such violence. And this is why I think that Fabio had a great idea in that it needs to be more of a police action. I would say special ops, people who are well-trained in the given discipline of dealing with these particulars. But the shock and awe stuff, oh, come on. I mean, we need to get rid of that altogether. That kind of mentality doesn't need to take...
As horrible as it was,
yes.
As horrible as it was, the average citizen in Iraq was far better off under Saddam Hussein than they are today, with an infrastructure totally destroyed, with a power set up completely evacuated from their country, the factions that Saddam Hussein was able to keep from warring with each other because of his own heavy hand, now warring with each other. The stupidity with which they went in there, not thinking that any of these things would come back to bite them in the butt. And by the way, it's not as if – I remember back in 2001 and 2002 and 2003, I was on a college campus. I'm talking about this stuff saying, do you know what's going to happen? And sure. When it happens, I feel powerless when I tell people, I told you that this is what was going to happen. And about the best I could do is just predict it and then watch it happen.
We live in a military town, and not very far from Pensacola, we have an Air Force base, as well as, you know, we have the Naval Air Station here in Pensacola, and then we have just right down the road an Air Force base. And then we have this huge area where they actually drop bombs like Moabs. And when we invaded Iraq, I can't even remember how many people told me, yeah, we need to drop many Moabs on those people. And I'm going, do what? And I think until we as Americans change our way of thinking, I think that we're inviting this stuff unto ourselves. It's crazy. Am I alone in this kind of thinking?
Evidently, you're not alone, but evidently those that are with you are not powerful enough. They don't have enough clout. They are considered. I can't tell you how many times I've argued for peace and against war mentality on my Facebook page, and I get responses to me like, "You got to stop smoking the PCP, Bob." You know, and you know, and people don't want to hear this, and they you know, and I agree with what Albert Einstein said. It says you can't solve your problems using the same kind of thinking that created them in the first place. You know, you know, by the way, this is one of the problems with trying to become a meaningful politician, is that too many times politicians are expected to have some answers before they get into office, when I think really what they need are processes and policies that they will pursue to hopefully discover and come up with answers based upon an appropriate approach of research, because a politician before he's in office doesn't have the money to do that kind of research and staff in order to do that. But unfortunately, once politicians get into office, they don't use their staff for those purposes. They use their staff for the purpose of figuring out how they can get reelected.
there is a comment that I want to read. It's from Stan. He said, "Yes, sir. The West foreign policy is a majority of the root of the problem, but many of us just trudge along, selling out to the system because we all need to live and eat. Everyone has their price. Sad face.
Yes, you know, and I think that's let's mention this again and point it out. I tell people, and they're kind of surprised. I drive a car. I am complicit, therefore, in the oil problem that we have because I drive a car. Now, what would I do if I didn't drive a car? Well, you know, the truth is we're a part of this culture and we have to find a way of making a living. We have to do this. And unfortunately, there are so many ways in which our culture is involved in doing things we don't even know that it's doing, creating various effects we don't even anticipate, that this is a multiplex of operations from a culture and a society, and there's no way to opt out. There's no way to opt out unless you're going to truly disadvantage yourself, and then from there, you can't do anything. So it really involves a paradigm shift that you're trying to bring to a culture, and before that paradigm shift changes, you have to know and participate in the current paradigm in order to be able to relate and change. And so that's difficult. That's in some sense a compromise, but there's no other way. There's no other way. We're stuck.
That's true. Makes it extremely slow.
That's true.
Yeah.
If no one else has anything to share on this particular topic, I want to shift, but I will give you a chance to say something before we do shift. Okay, let's move right along. Yeah. Fabio, you were on the show the other night with us with David Silverman, and Vincent, I think that you listened to the show and you were very much impressed with David Silverman. It was awesome. I want to read a few comments, and I would like for you guys to respond, because one of the things that I want to do, I want to try to generate a little bit of excitement about, you know, his new work coming out. I mean, I think it's going to be a work of art. I know David Silverman from doing several shows with him and speaking with him from time to time. He's an awesome individual, and I think that he's trying to raise the bar here. And I think that if people buy his book, I think they're going to be doing themselves, you know, a favor, to be honest with you. But I wanted to read some of the comments that have been left after we put the show in the archives. Here's the first point, and this one was by you, Vincent. Very excited about David Silverman's new book. Would you like to comment on that before I go to the next comment?
Yes, I am. I'm very, very excited. I think it's going to be a good book. He's very swift and precise in his way of explaining things. I think that when I saw the cover, I was like, "Wow, I got to get it!" You know, so I'm very excited by the book.
He's going to visit Phoenix, as you heard, and when he does,
yes, I heard, yeah.
When he does, you go to the book signing and also get a book signed. To me, I'll send you the money to buy the book and to ship it to me. I'd love to have a signed copy of the book. Yeah.
I asked him to have a book signed by Saiten, but.
I've invited Saiten and Eric back on the program. They won't even come up.
Yeah. I want to photograph while he's signing that, so that's how we know that he's signing. But still,
yeah. I wrote an article, a little blog there on my Facebook about that's called "How Do You Know That," and it was about Saiten Brüggen Gates' henchman.
Okay, here's the next comment. This is Tony. He said, "A process rather than a conclusion." Well said, Dr. Jones. I love it when you have David on. Great show. Thanks, guys. You know, I think that it's when people make a commitment to a process rather than a conclusion, I think that's when we all move forward. I'm a part of so many theistic groups and also atheist groups. I'm very, very proud these days to be able to talk to both groups and However, I get more hell out of the theist than I do out of the atheist for some reason. I don't know why, but I've been thrown out of many groups. I've never been thrown out of an atheist group, but I've been thrown out of many theistic groups, if that says anything. Let's go on. This one gentleman says, Silverman/Bob 2016. So cast your vote now. You can do a write-in. That was good. Scott says, the place continues to be my favorite thing about the internet. Why would you think that he would say something like that, Fabio?
Of course it is. I mean, where else are you going to go? I mean, well, there is porn, which is not bad on the internet. Yeah, I would say porn and then the place.
Yeah, and I
in that order. Boom. Oh yeah, of course in that order. Come on, you know, you gotta have your priorities straight, you know, Vincent. Yeah.
It's just that we're not porn often enough. I think that's all it is.
Okay, Thomas Adams. He made a comment but asked a question. He said, "When exactly did Dr. Jones reject Jesus? I'm curious, watching the evolution of his thought process over the years." Number one, I did not reject Jesus, and sometimes I may misspeak, so let me clarify that. I rejected the other night that Jesus was Lord. I rejected the notion that Jesus is my Savior. I reject the notion that He's the King of Kings and Lord of Lords. I reject all of that. I reject that He saved me. I rejected my baptism. I rejected my salvation. But I find that Jesus is, that is the Jesus narrative, I should say. I find it to be compelling when it comes to compassionism. And it's not perfect. It has a lot of imperfection to it. I think that we can improve it. But when it comes to Jesus, I'm very much a fan. And so I have not rejected Jesus, that is, the Jesus narrative at all. But I'm a big fan. I don't think that He died for your sins. I don't think that He was buried and was resurrected from the dead. Buried, yes, after being murdered. But resurrected, no, not in the classical sense of theology. Resurrection, that is, as it's talked about in the Greek sense, that is, in the Gospels, he states that I am the resurrection. It's a bit of nuance. It's something that he was trying to suggest so people would not be so afraid. I will go into that in a teaching session at some point. I'd be glad to. But I did not reject, you know, Jesus in the sense that, you know, I don't like the guy. I'm a big fan. And so hopefully that does answer the question. Thanks for asking. There's another. And by the way, am I unclear sometimes as to where I'm at? That is, where I stand from time to time. I don't mind being critiqued here.
You know, if you take a stance that is not typical, it's many times just difficult to understand simply because it doesn't fit in any of the boxes we've been keeping on the shelf. And I would have to say that I wouldn't be surprised if each of us here at NCG have very similar but also nuanced different attitudes about some of these things too. So, you know, since we're all over the place.
Well put, Bob.
Yeah, go on, Daryl. I'm sorry.
Oh, that's all I was going to say. I like this response. Go ahead.
No, it's okay. I was, go on though, because I lost my thought.
I forgot.
Yeah. He ripped it out of your tongue. Yeah.
No, I think a lot of things that are misunderstood because they're so unusual and they don't fit the normal criteria. So people, you know, draw wrong conclusions or take it too far, that sort of thing.
That's what I was going to say. I was going to say that my attraction to the show in the first place was because it was not boxed in to with a label on it on a shelf. I think all of you, Bob and Dr. Jones, both of you have very different ways of being theists. I even joked with my daughter and said they're the most atheist theists I ever known in my life.
True.
Because you guys think like atheists, but you are also theists, and I understand how you are theists. And I think Dr. Jones, you just explained yourself very well. I don't think it's very ambiguous. I think it's unusual, and that's what makes some people react a little too fast and a little bit too judgmental. On how you guys, express yourselves. So that's what I thought.
It's a shame that Bob Jones University has the has really capitalized on that word unusual. most unusual university, what have you? Because I think we've earned that title. We're the most unusual set of theists you'll find. I think
a lot of folks have.
I'm not trying to be either. I'm just being honest with what I can be, and although I think I know a lot of things, there's also a lot of things I don't know, and so everything I think is a combination of everything I know and everything I don't know. So it's just whatever.
Okay, there's another comment in the comment section on our last show with David Silverman. It says a lot of meat in this show. Thanks, really made me think.
Cool.
I hope that our show is getting people to think, especially about the text. I keep saying that most of the great debate has absolutely nothing to do with the text. It has more to do with the pushback on synthetic models of theology, especially the failed meta-language of theology. And so
we've had over 700 views of that show since Sunday.
Yeah.
Just to make you feel guys a little bit better, I mean, I'm talking about Bob and Dr. Jones. There was a famous person, one of my most favorite persons, a mathematician named Martin Gardner. He was famous because he published mathematical games in Scientific American. He was very famous. And he was the founder of the Skeptical Inquirer and the Center for the Research of Paranormal Activity. It was with James Randi. He was one of the founders, and he was a fideistic theist. So, one thing doesn't say that you cannot be the other. It was against charlatans. He didn't believe, in things. He was a very good skeptic, a mathematician, but he was a fideistic theist. So,
yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Just want to make you feel a little bit better, guys. I'm making you a good company there.
Yeah.
Come on,
yeah.
Cheer up.
Most people don't even think that I'm a theist at all, which is fine with me. But this leads to the next question. A gentleman, this guy, he really likes the show. He said, I Googled multi-axial theist and got nothing. I'd love for Dr. Jones to define that. It sounds delightful. It's going to take an entire show to do that, simply because when we keep talking about looking at things from a different axis, I think that we need to take our time in discussing that, because I think too many times we rush into things without really a good explanation. And so let's do a show on that, Bob, pretty quick. What do you
say?
And
if I could just say quickly, when I became multiaxial as a theist, I became multiaxial as a person. And by that, I meant this. Most of us, when we find puzzles in life, we try to figure out an answer to the puzzle. And when we come across an answer that seems to us to be coherent, we go, oh, I found the answer. And we settle there and we move on to the next question. Or as a multi-axial person, you find what seems to be a coherent answer to the question. You go, well, that's one way of looking at it. I wonder if there's other ways of looking at it, and recognizing the puzzle might actually be like an optical illusion, that there's more than one way you could actually see something materializing in it. And a multi-axial person can many times entertain even mutually exclusive notions about a way and recognize they're both a way of looking at this and they both have some use value. Which one's true? Oh, I don't know. I have no idea. I have no way of knowing. And in a sense, I don't even care. I just want to make sure that when I look at things, I try to come up with a coherent way that's consistent of looking at it. And if I happen to have a number of axes upon which I'm considering an issue so that I can look at it from several different ways, then I'm being multi-axial. Like in politics, I can be liberal, I can be conservative, I can be libertarian, all at the same time, and recognizing that each of these might have something to say that comes from a particular standpoint, that from that standpoint is a very coherent view, and that to be multi-axial is to try to really take on as many different potentially valid viewpoints as you can.
Bob, you just made a great intro for the show.
I like that
show.
A lot. Can I say, I always give this example.
Okay, your audio is cutting up a little bit. Okay.
Oh, is it?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Just. How is it now?
Is it better?
Is it better?
Okay, try it again.
Is it better now?
Try it again.
Can you hear me now?
Can you hear me? His audio is bad. Let me.
It sounds like you have a connector jacket to.
Okay. Give me a minute.
Do you hear me now?
Yeah.
There you go.
Yeah. I put that microphone away. It's my Mac microphone. Okay. So what I've said, I've probably said it before. Or you've heard it before. It's that it's about vantage point. We all have a vantage point, and from that vantage point, we have a perspective. And I always give the example of a stop sign. If I'm in front of a stop sign, and that's my vantage point, I see the stop sign, I see the form of the stop sign. But if I'm on the side, if my vantage point is on the side of that stop sign, all I see is a pole with a red part of the pole that goes up, because I see only one line. If somebody is between both vantage points, they see the sign, a little bit distorted. But they see that it's a circle or whatever. So what I mean is that what I like about what Bob just said is that the more vantage points we walk to and are willing to stand on, the more perspectives we will have. And those perspectives are all different facets of the same thing, but we don't see it the same way. The problem is with people, with humans in general, is like Bob said, we stand at a vantage point, we see what it is. Oh, it's just a pole with a little bit of red on top of it. Because we're on the side, for example,
and then we're
happy with it, right? So that's just an example, an illustration. But I think that illustration shows a little bit what Bob said.
What's the best way to handle money? The answer to that question can be very different if you're a very wealthy person or if you're a very, very poor mm-hmm. person. And there will be things that will make sense to the poor person that won't make sense to the wealthy person, and vice versa. And they're both in very different circumstances and situations. So both of them can't even really appreciate some of the things the other side has to actually be a little careful of, And
exactly.
If you're very wealthy, you don't know who your friends are with your money. And if you're very poor, you can't always risk the putting money forth to make more money, because if you lose that, you're mm-hmm. you're gone. So, very different attitudes. Yeah. So the vantage points. Sometimes you don't even have to decide which one has the use value that is important.
You guys are doing a great teaser for the show. One of the things that I'd like to get into is the meat and the bones of it. Because, for instance, when using various kinds of methodologies, it's interesting to see that, the outcome will be different. And so I'd like to approach this, that is, with scientific modeling, to
sure.
demonstrate that there is a bit of sense to this. This is not just how we speak poetically. And from time to time, we do like to nuance poetically, but from time to time, we'll get back into the science of it. And so that's going to be a dynamic program, in my opinion. It's going to be fun.
The comment I thought was very good, because I've never heard any other – before I met you, Dr. Jones, I never heard anybody else ever use the term, being multi-axial. And I used to teach on being multi-axial just in the standpoint of trying to understand oneself, you know, in a sense of personal identity and things like that. And I even, you know, gave a seminar on that. And then when I met you, we met really over linguistic issues. And then you started, you're using the term multi-axis. I go, what, huh? What? You know, don't steal my term, man. You know, and so it is rare. It is odd and rare, but we found each other.
That's true. But let's, I mean, since you've said so much about this, let's go ahead and commit to this. Being a multi-axial theist means that we are not truly a classical theist.
No, no, not at all.
In fact, it means that we've left that world entirely. True?
Right. We're in the process rather than the conclusion. Now, I have tentative conclusions and I have ideas. I don't invest that much in them sometimes, and sometimes I do, but that's really just trial and error, you know?
Right. Yeah. So if we've left the context of classical theism, and most people have construed us as people still in that world of classical theism, what does that suggest, Bob?
We were disappointing a lot of people, unfortunately.
That's weird, Fabio. What say you?
I say that I think I found the perfect definition of you. And again, it's from a, because I looked into that, because I knew that the Martin Gardner reference would be interesting. This is what he said in 2008, and I think it makes a very good picture of both you and Bob. And or I might be totally wrong, because I'm having wine here. So he said, "I am a philosophical theist. I believe in a personal God, and I believe in an afterlife, and I believe in prayer, but I don't believe in any established religion. Philosophical theism is entirely emotional. As Kant said, it destroyed pure reason to make room for faith." And I think it paints you to, makes a very good picture of you two right now.
Huh.
Ha-ha!
Yeah.
We'll see after the show. I mean, wow.
I'll send you the quote so you can, yeah, you can read it carefully. Sure. But I'll send you the quote.
Yeah, you know, Martin Gardner.
You know, one of the things that people here in the studio, they know that I'm not a classical theist. And this is why a lot of people, especially on shows, have been a little bit confused. And a lot of people are saying, you know, why don't you just come out and say what you are? I said, well, it's not really that easy, because I'm not really a part of the debate between theism and atheism, because I left theism. In other words, being a multi-axial theist, in a sense, has nothing at all to do with theism. That is in the classical sense. And it really has nothing to do with atheism in the classical sense. And so I'm fumbling over my words here. It is what it is. But I've moved on. And this is what multi-axial theists do. And it's because of methodology. And we need to discuss that.
Yeah.
I think you guys are like journey, and instead of stopping and looking around, you actually keep on walking, but slowly, to see everything. I think that's what it is. It's a journey, and that's what I want to be too. I don't want to be an atheist. I am an atheist, just for all practical reasons, but the truth is I feel I'm more a conversationalist. You know, I like to talk and understand things little by little. So, like you say, you always say it's a process, and that's what it is. I'm not against saying that there's some conclusions made, like Bob hinted on, because we do make conclusions, but those conclusions are part of the process. They're right. Like, you know, little stops, that's all.
Yeah.
What does stop mean? What does stop mean? I'm confused.
Pause. Let's say pause.
Sleep. Sometimes you stop and eat, and sometimes you stop to smell the flowers.
I don't even know what a stop sign looks like. Come on.
Yeah.
Play ball with me.
Well, let's say it's not a stop but a pause. You pause to reflect. You pause to like Bob said, to eat. But you just pause. That pause is a little conclusion. It concludes a moment. It's like a comma.
It's you know what they call a pause.
Exactly. You put a comma, not a period, on anything, and you keep moving, and you challenge that comma. In other words, you may put two commas right in a row. In other words, is it grammatically correct? You say, fuck that. Let me see if I can use commas in a different way. Mm-hmm. You're willing to try to improve possibly the box that you've been boxed in.
Yeah.
And you even try to get outside of that box. Yeah.
The reason for that, when I say there's some little conclusions that are only part of the process, is because at one point we have to stop and think and digest what we ate, what we read, what we heard. We have to digest it, and then we make from that we make a little bit of a conclusion on things. Doesn't mean that that conclusion is definitive. It just means that that's a little pause. And now we keep on walking. We keep on trying to find more.
And sometimes
I agree. It's like trying to read a huge wall of text, or the very same text properly formatted. It makes all the difference.
Sometimes you have to make a decision, and the decision means I have to make this decision as best as I can, given the vantage points I've considered up until this time, and I'm ready to take a risk. You know. But I'm also ready to learn a lesson because, you know, wisdom comes from experience, and experience comes from foolishness, and foolishness comes from trying things out, you know.
But,
by the way, I can testify to the fact that Dr. Jones really believes in commas because I visited Pensacola, and he drove me around, and he doesn't pay attention to stop signs.
Now we'll know everything.
I don't pay attention for various reasons. Okay, moving right along. I'm glad that people are enjoying the place. Many people have asked the question, why don't we have the huge numbers? To be honest with you, I don't know. We just do what we can do, and it is what it is. But I know that I'm committed to humanity, a process. I would like to see people become compassionist, humanist, after the best order. I want to see at the end of the day people being able to get along, people who can think, people who can embrace one another, accept one another, who can work with one another. And I think that it's when atheists and theists alike can say, wow, we're just people, and why work everything out of the model of our position? Why not look at theories about this and that simply as explanations that are in flux? And so are they really conclusions? In a sense, they are, but they're like a door that keeps moving, if you will, that says, wow, we're attempting to explain something, and in reality, I like what Steven Pinker says about mind science and linguistics. He said that thoughts are not language. And sometimes I think that we get stuck in language thinking that what we have said here tonight is equivalent to our thoughts, and that's not true. What we're doing is we're trying to put our thoughts we're trying to convey our thoughts through the utility of language, but we must admit to the facts. The facts say that we're not getting it all out, identical to how it's perceived in the head. And so what's inside the head typically can't come out identical, and therefore the person listening cannot grasp completely what one has said. And so, therefore, there is a lot of patience that is required in a true conversation, simply because we're trying to use language, a very imperfect vehicle, if you will, to transport from here to the receptor and from that person back to this receptor. And so I think that as a human being, we need to learn how to say, wow, science has improved our understanding of each other. And that means this requires a lot of kindness, patience. It requires of us to be faithful, that is, in staying with the process, and not so much to the conclusion, because by the time that I listen to everyone speak, I'm painfully aware that I'm really not grasping all of their thoughts, and I'm capable of mishearing, misspeaking, and doing all kinds of things like that, and so it is what it is. And so I'm thankful for the place where imperfection is accepted as part of the norm, in a sense. It's not that we're trying to be so imperfect. We are accepting where we are, if that makes any sense. Do we have any final comments? I'm just rambling here tonight. I'm enjoying you guys. You guys are wonderful people. And I just like having you on the show because you guys are awesome, period. And so the subject has been good. My heart is heavy tonight for all of those victims, their families. I just hurt for them. But I think that we can change this dynamic. And so anyone can jump in. Daryl, why don't you go first?
Well, you know, the conversation about being multi-axial, it seems to me, I'm going to go out on somewhat of a limb here, that quite possibly could be the thing that could help move humanity forward. Because, you know, if I'm open to consider all the possibilities, so to speak, of any equation, then that means I'm willing to listen to you and to someone else. And because I want the vantage point, because I'm not locked into my own way of thinking as if I'm right and I know I'm right, I keep myself open to consider the possibility, even sometimes the likelihood, that I don't have all the information I need to draw any final conclusion, and therefore I need to listen to someone else and consider possibly something that I can't see from where I'm at. I could say the same thing, and I think I will, when it comes to the people in Paris tonight. You know, there's probably someone somewhere, I hope not, but there's quite possibly, I mean, we hear this sort of thing, that someone would say, well, you know, if these people weren't living in Paris, this wouldn't have happened to them. You know, I mean, that's how biased people can become in their thinking. But to really grasp the gravity of the situation, I've got to be able to consider it from their vantage point. You know, what would it be like? I mean, I go to a restaurant, I go to the theater, I go to these places, and I think about it. You know, when I'm sitting in a theater sometimes, I'll think about, you know, someone bursting in the exit with a gun. I mean, it happens to people. And when I think about it in that, you know, it helps me identify and realize the reality of what some people have gone through. And it enables me to be more sympathetic and more compassionate. So I love the idea of the vantage point of multi-axial.
Fabio, what are your final thoughts?
Okay, 4 points, which I want to make, because there might be some not misunderstanding, but I want to further clarify 4 points. The first one, we briefly touched on the immigrant problem. There is a problem in Europe about the immigrants. People coming from Syria, people coming from other parts of Africa. Let's not forget what Boko Haram is doing, you know, in the center of Africa. These are the people which are fleeing from those situations. Is it a problem? Yes, it is a problem. It must be dealt accordingly. It must be dealt for what it is. We must not make we must not allow demagogy to become the way that we approach that problem. There might be people, you know, coming here, you know, for reasons which are not the real reason they declare, but we got to understand and face the problem for what it is. people which are running away from where they always lived. They are living people over there, they're living family, and they have no other chance of bloody living, being better. It's life or death. That's the first point. The second point regards, and you, Dr. Jones, you briefly touched it. I don't want to be misunderstood. I'm firmly convinced that the problem of terrorism is a police matter. Having said that, and I am a pacifist, I've been a conscientious objector. I didn't go in the army. In my country, it was mandatory to go, to serve 1 year in the army. And I made 1 year and a half somewhere else because I didn't want to go in the army. But having said that, I recognize that there might be reasons and ways and scenarios where a war is necessary. The problem is that if you need to go to war with someone, with a country, with a society, with ISIS, with whatever, you have got to be committed. You go there, you establish the objective, you fulfill the objective, and then you go away. You don't leave the troops on the ground. You don't try to rebuild, because that's a problem which is happening in Iran, in Iraq. If you try to rebuild, everything else is an excuse. You cannot say, no, I went there because there was that bad guy. When you made million and billion and billion of dollars in that business, you are not justified anymore. So if you have to have an intervention, you go there, as surgical as it might be, and then you go away, because it is the only possible way you can do that. You don't try to impose your system in a society, in a country which doesn't accept it, and it didn't want that. The third point, I'm almost there. I have said that I don't think that religion is part of the problem and with ISIS. That's not correct. It is part of the problem, but it's not the biggest part of the problem. The only thing that I would say about religion is that, unfortunately, and it is because I'm blissfully ignorant about Islam, okay? So I'll lay it down really clearly, and I want someone to come here on the place and explain it to me. Unfortunately, the perception that we have of Islam, that I have of Islam, is of a religion which can be easily exploited into an ideology. I don't know why, I don't know if it's true, but this is the state of the matter right now. There is no other religion I am aware of, and I don't know why it has happened with Islam, that can be turned so easily into an ideology. And I would love to have an imam here and tell me exactly what the hell is really Islam. Because I don't believe it's that. It cannot be that. It cannot be the same religion which, made an entire area of Europe flourish in mathematics, in culture, in literature. It cannot be the same one. There is something wrong here. I don't know what it is. I don't understand. I want someone to come here and explain to me. But that, unfortunately, is the perception. The fourth one, and I'm over. In Italy, we refer to the French, and this is something that we do only with the French. We usually call the French cousins. We refer to the French as our French cousins, the population of France. Now, cousin is still part of the family, and it's funny because, it's not really your brother, it's not really your mother, it's part of your family, and you might have a cousin which pisses you off every so often. But they're still cousins, and this is exactly the relation that we have as Italians with the French. After the attacks, I was devastated. But then I found the strangely enough, I found the motto of the coat of arms of Paris, and it's in Latin, And so I'm testing Dr. Jones and Bob here. It's not true, because I already told them what it means. So if they say they know, it's just because I told them. But the motto is fluctuat nec mergitur. And in layman's term, it means tossed in the water, but still floating. And this is my hope, you know, for the French right now, and for Paris in particular. It is tossed in the water. It is a boat which nobody, you know, it has problems. It might not work right. It is literally been taken and tossed in the Seine, but it's floating. It doesn't go down. It doesn't sink. It doesn't sink. Sorry.
Excellent. Excellent. You know, one of the things that I hope that the young boy's father is right. I'm hoping that it's the simplicity of love and compassion, simply having a flower. I'm hoping that that kind of approach will put an end to this, you know, chaos. However, I do leave the door open for other options. And I like the way that you put it, surgically so. That's very, very powerful. Vincent, what are your final thoughts?
Well, this was a good show, I thought. I'm really thankful for Fabio being there. He's pretty amazing. Well, my thoughts are that it's not just a Paris thing. I think that it happened in Paris, like 9/11 happened in New York. I think that it's a bigger problem, a more international problem than just Paris, even though I have my heart in Paris. But I still think it's more than that. I think that religion does have a role in it, but I don't think that role is prominent. I don't think it's... it happens that in Lyon, France, I lived in Lyon, France too, I studied with an imam, I accepted to study with him the Quran, and he actually was kind of mad after a year and a half that I was not adopting his point of view of the Quran. And he started getting mad, and he started getting, to my point of view, a little bit dangerous, so I kind of left him and moved. It was a time where I moved. So I never heard of him again. But I can tell you one thing, is that the Quran, as a basis, is not a book of peace. It is not, just like the Bible is not. And unfortunately, the ones that are the most fundamentalists are actually obeying the Quran. So my thought is that although this ISIS thing is not specifically religious, I think it's more of a... Actually, I think it's more political than religious. But religion is there, and they claim to follow the Quran. And actually, they're right. They do follow the Quran, and that's my problem. I side with Sam Harris. This is to conclude. I side with Sam Harris about moderate Muslims that need to do something. And I think that moderate Muslims or Christians give a little bit of an excuse to the fundamentalist ones. Now, that's another discussion altogether that I would like to talk about one day.
You know, one of the things that I'd like to do, we've had a wonderful gentleman on the place, Professor Mendo, and he gets a lot of death threats, that is, from the Islamic community. Simply because he's considered extremely liberal, but he's very sound. But I'd like for him to come on the show several times and answer a lot of questions, because I think that people who stand in positions, namely of trying to argue for their text base, whatever it might be, whether it be Nestle Island 27th edition or one... modeling of what we call the Quran. I think that people do owe the community some kind of explanation as to why we should keep this and that around and not simply on the shelf somewhere in some library. And so with that said, I think that would be a good thing. Before we leave the program, I would like to ask you a favor, Vincent, because you are a singer and you lived in Paris. Is there a song that comes to you that you might just sing a cappella, maybe a verse or two that would make sense to this show? I mean, that would be wonderful.
I am terrible with lyrics, whether in English or French.
You could just make them up as you go along.
There's a song I heard this morning, actually, that reminded, an old song that reminded me of Paris, and that was Paris, Seveille. Probably Fabio knows that one. Of course, I forget the words. What can I sing that I would know?
Berezanka?
Berezanka, I know, yes. I'm trying to figure out. I have some dirty songs. I'm not going to sing those ones. Yeah. Do you speak French? Do you, right?
Un petit peu. C'est terrible.
Non, mais tu parles bien. Tu prononces banlieue bien. Sorry.
I speak French un petit bit.
Voilà. There's a song of Edith Piaf that's about Paris, which is nicknamed Paname, and it's a great song. If you, I'll try to put a link to it. I love Edith Piaf, and I love Jacques Brel. Jacques Brel is Belgian, but he's, he sings in French.
Could you sing the national anthem or anything like that? We would just love for you to sing something in French.
Let me see. C'est dur. It's hard. You caught me off guard there.
I'm sorry.
No. I would have worked on one. But
hey, listen, Vincent. I mean, don't. It mustn't be a problem for that. I mean, last Sunday, Dr. Jones, at the end of the show, he asked me point blank a recipe. And I wanted to kill him. So now it's your turn. So deal with it. Do your best and go ahead. Because there is no way out of it.
I'll do one that everybody knows in French. It's a little lullaby. It's Au clair de la lune, mon ami Pierrot, prête-moi ta plume pour écrire un mot. Ma chandelle est morte, je n'ai plus de feu. Ouvre-moi ta porte pour l'amour de Dieu. And there, it's Au clair de la lune.
That's wonderful.
It's a little lullaby that we sing to kids. It's about the singers asking to borrow your pen because he has no more ink, and his candle is going down, and he can't see anymore. But it's just a little lullaby. So there you go.
My grandfather's, he was Swedish, and my grandmother was 100% Norwegian. And my grandfather would sing me to sleep in his language rather than in English, and I really enjoyed that. But that's another story. We're getting close to the end of the show, Bob. What are your final thoughts, and we're out of here?
Well, it's been a very serious show, and I'm glad that we had this and had a number of things to say. I'm glad we had the participants in. I think you may have noticed that we specifically avoided asking Vincent about what he'd do with refugees because his name is Deporter, and we weren't sure. our hearts, go out to people who suffer. My anger and my heart go out to the people whose suffering has led them to think that violence is an answer. We live in a world where I don't think we have some easy answers, but I think we're too too quick to think we have some good ones that aren't really working for us as well as we had claimed they would. They don't. So I, like Fabio, I'm very much a conscientious objector and a peacemaker. But I just hope that through multi-axiality, which we'll talk about at some other time, that we can actually, you know, adopt and be able to, like they say, walk a mile in a number of pairs of shoes, so that we can, you know, learn to perceive how things are from someone else's perspective. By the way, the reason why before you criticize and abuse, you should walk a mile in someone else's shoes is this, that once you've walked a mile in their shoes, you can criticize and abuse them because now you're a mile away from them and you have their shoes. So it worked.
Okay, I'm going to do something for my grandson. He likes this stuff, and here's it's on my cell phone. Oh, yeah. Oh, I love that.
Who is it?
Okay, that's Gangnum Style with Hammer. MC Hammer's on that. Oh, he is awesome.
MC Hammer, he's got so much energy. It's amazing.
He really does. I mean, he really put it together with Psy. Not Psy Tim Brueggenkate, another Psy. The good one. But they did an amazing job with that song. And one of my grandsons, two of my grandsons love dancing to that. And this studio lights up when my grandchildren start dancing. In fact, I think we had 25 to 30 of the kids on stage Sunday morning, and they were dancing like crazy. And the rest of them were in the seats because we have a lot of fun in the studio. We really, really think that kids, need a chance to just let go and enjoy life. And some of the songs they came up with, Bob, my wife and I, we were trying to keep up with it, but one talks about Stanky Leg or something like that. It was fun, lots of fun. Maybe we will make some of those shows live. We've been doing a lot of private shows, simply trying to gather footage. Right now, what we have going on in the studio is more successful than what NCG has ever seen. The last 3 months have been dynamic. We want you to be a part of what's going on. So with that said, let's say good night. On the count of three, everyone together, good night. One, two, three.
Good night.
Good night.
Thank you, guys. Thank you.